Welcome back. It's the Summit 2 by G2Way.com, the Europe division. We are in day number 14 of European games, and, well, we are on to now game number 5. Apologies, of course, for the bit of delay. As you can imagine, there is so much Dota happening right now, and specifically so much European Dota. It's spread between 3 or 4 different organizations, so these players are playing a lot of games stacked all on top of each other. They're going from one to the next, hopping around. They got 2 more to do here, then 5 more to go over there. They're trying to eat, they're trying to piss, they're trying to do everything they can, but it's a bit of a hot mess. But appreciate, as always, my co-caster has been joining me through this long, long day of Dota. It's going to be none other than Blaze. My friend, we've made it to game number 5 now. It's going to be a matchup between Na'Vi taking on the Balkan Bears, who are already out of contention to make it into playoffs. But this could be a clowny game, nonetheless. I don't know. Both teams are feeling pretty rambunctious and a bit tired at this point.
Yeah, I suppose so. Looking at the two, I mean, obviously there's some real interesting drafts coming out already. BBC, they're an easy team to underestimate. They're ones that, I mean, coming out of the qualifiers, they looked like they were really strong against Tier 2 teams and really weak against Tier 1 teams, but they've actually made some really good wins happen, and I really like the initiation style of players like Pedrino, and yeah, clowny is a good word for it. If you look at this draft, they are looking to all in. They are looking to, like, I think, like, as far as the psychological aspect of this draft is kind of coming into play here, because it looks like they want to end this game sooner rather than later. Spearbreaker is a very aggressive hero, charging in, finding kills. Less Track and Nature's Prophet has the ability with a level 1 Edict, level 1 Nature's Call to actually take a tower before the 2-minute mark. I mean, it's insane. So there is a lot of push, there's a lot of gank, there's a lot of kill potential, and I think one aspect of it is that the outer game factor is kind of coming into this one. BBC, they're in a gaming spree. They've been playing a lot of games. They have 2 or 3 more to go. If they end this game a little bit ahead of schedule, then that's kind of their meal ticket. They get to take a bit of a break and refresh, recalibrate for the rest of the day. So yeah, I think that they do have some intentions of closing this one out fast, and Na'Vi better keep that in mind.
Yeah, I mean, they were even making note that they were hoping to kind of maybe have opportunity to eat, but unfortunately they're not going to have that luxury. So like you said, man, they're going to try to get this game done damn near quick. Lishrek with the pushing power. Spearbreaker is going to add constant pressure. They could just kind of throw it all out there, and if they don't get the job done within 20 minutes, 25 minutes, they might just GG out of it for all we know. I mean, they are unfortunately not in contention anymore to make it to playoffs, but if they do want to take a strong game, still make a strong appearance as the team together, as their own individual, you know, players worth, and obviously being able to bring down Na'Vi is a big, big feat in itself. And, well, if they're able to keep Na'Vi out of maybe the top 4 and force them into tiebreakers, one thing could lead to another, and they couldn't even make the playoffs. So each of these games still very much matter. And Na'Vi still have a very formidable lineup here. Tidehunter grabbed once again. Funnik has been dishing out so much work already today with that Tidehunter. Skywrath Mage follow-up makes for an easy grab right there on Vanskor. Earthshaker going to be the secondary support grab, I imagine, potentially FNG. And now we're going to look to see what kind of core hero that Havos is going to be bringing out for himself. But also, funny to note, the, of course, Respect Meepo ban towards Weeha.
Radiant team.
Yeah, you gotta throw that one out there just in case they're trying to pull some real shenanigans and make things difficult for you. So they do take out the Meepo. They still pick up the Earthshaker as a good turtle hero and good for roaming around in the early game. We've seen some really good plays from FNG on that hero in particular. But they're going to back to one that they ran before, which is the Necrophos for Havost. A lot of potential there, and it's also really good against Legion Commander. Before Legion Commander gets a BKB, if she commits to a duel on a hero that's not Necrophos, she could be handing dual damage away, because the Necrophos is a really good finisher hero. And that's something to be very wary of. And I don't think that BBC have as much room in this draft to play the style that we saw was against the Necrophos last time around. Last time they had a Witch Doctor and a Dazzle. keep Poop alive and to minimize the impact of that hero, it was on the back of the Tide. Some really great plays from Funnik that were able to actually make the win happen because the Necrophos couldn't always find those Reaper sites. But in this case, BBC don't really have any tools of preventing it. No heals, no graves.
10 seconds remaining.
If Na'Vi ban out like a Dazzle here, which I don't think is a threat because of the fact that Leshrac and Spiritbreaker are your supports. I don't know. I just don't see a way of BBC preventing Necrophos from getting a kill every 90 seconds.
Yeah, I mean, we're banking on a position for Spiritbreaker here, which has definitely been done. I know Root Gaming and some other people like to roll it in the four position and make things nice and spicy, but we've seen other teams like Beachy Squad have Ice for up Spiritbreaker in off lane. I don't know
Radiant
if I've seen
team pick.
You know, that really happened or not, but as far as the lineup that potentially could be here, yeah, Nature's Prophet's also there, but he could also be ran as a number four, as we see in the hands of EG, and also could be ran as a mid lane. It's still a flexible draft here for the side of BBC as far as how they're going to line it up. I mean, hell, even Liege Commander has an off-lane position technically, but how they're going to run it all out, we're going to find out in a moment. They're a Pubstar player, Weeha. This could be his fifth grab. I'm not too sure. I mean, we've seen big things from Invoker from him in the past. How is much that really offers to the table here against Na'Vi? I'm not too sure. Their ban, though, is going to be on Sven. And Na'Vi are banking that they're going to go for a Medusa grab here and ban on Medusa with their final pick.
Yeah, there's a possibility. I really like the synergy between the Legion Commander's duel and the Stone Gaze, because you're going to force them to look at one direction, and you can cause some real problems there. In the end, they do go for a core hero and Na'Vi's have that Spirit Breaker relegated to a supportive initiator. But the Invoker is an interesting choice. The Sunstrike is what you're looking for there. It's definitely got to be an Exhort Invoker, and you're looking to follow up the duels. Really just ramp up momentum with some duel damage and turn this into a bit of a pub train. Just kill after kill after kill. Keep on ramping up, and almost every 50 seconds you're looking for duels. So it's kind of interesting. Legion Commander and Necrophos are the two heroes that need the setup. They need follow-through with their abilities. You get some good damage, you follow it up with Reaper Scythe. You get a good opportunity, you start off with a duel. So these two ultimates, Necrophos and Legion Commanders, are going to be determining the momentum of the game. They're revolving and deciding who's going to be in the action and gaining momentum.
And with the final grab on the side of Na'Vi, they're going to get their precious Dendi Templar Assassin, which we've seen each day now, and each time he pulls out tremendous work in that mid lane. He's bringing in not only huge CS for himself, but huge denies as well, really taking advantage of the recent changes and taking that away from the opposing mid laner, which could very well be Weeha here. And the Invoker, like I said, man, he has done such good work. If you haven't already seen, for anyone watching, this guy can play a mean Invoker, and we'll see if he's going to bring it to the table in this one as we do get underway.
Prepare for battle.
Fifth game matchup. Both teams very anxious to get this one over pretty quick so they can move on to other games, other tasks, other objectives. It's clear that these players are pretty rushed on what they want to do, so we'll see if they get it done. On your Radiant side, it's the Balkan Bears. Unfortunately, they are out of playoff contention, sporting, I believe, a 1-7 record. It's going to be Haki who's heading towards the top offlane position on this Legion Commander. In your mid lane, it's going to be none other than Weeha. Going to be playing your Invoker. On the bottom, we are going to have Solitude going to be playing your Spirit Breaker. It looks like he is going to be playing that number four position. Levi is going to be playing your Leshrac. I believe this is a core farming Leshrac, or they still have Nature's Prophet behind. This could be, I guess, just straight to a jungle Nature's Prophet then, played by Pad Reno, Pad Reinho.
30 seconds to battle.
I've been hearing Quadrino mostly, so that's Quadrino. What I've been going with there. But yeah, it'll be interesting to see the kind of greed come into play. But if they can get away with it, then after about 5 or 6 minutes, they'll turn into a hard pushing Nature Prophet with 2 or 3 points in Nature's Call, causing a lot of problems. And of course, you can also supplement the duel with the global presence of the Wrath of Nature, the teleport. So I'm looking to get him off his feet pretty quickly. Anyways, on the side of Na'Vi, we're going to be seeing Dendi take up the mid lane, couple branches, going for that bottle really early. It's going to be, of course, the Ghost on this Necrophos safe lane, looking for an early Basilius. Vanskor is going to be supporting him on the Skywrath Mage. And down bottom, you're going to be seeing Fissure Block come out from the Earthshaker, blocking off the creep wave, and that is going to be FNG playing the Earthshaker. And then finally it is Phonic on that Tidehunter boots first.
And there he goes, right back to a lane of a hero in a position he is just so familiar with. One creep makes it out in the front, so he'll be taking the brunt force of that wave first and foremost, and allowing the equilibrium to proceed towards the tower, where Phonic will be able to take advantage of some CS under the big structure. But I'm curious, man, this is a battle of two big titans here in the mid lane between this Invoker, but top lane we might see a potential early engagement. Haki wasn't Viz, but instead just goes for the last hit right there on Havost, who's still nearby. There's just too many supports in the woods lingering about. They're both currently doing stack work right now, getting some pulls, and then you're going to see Vanskor kind of complete pull through and just try to deny as much creeps as possible and away from this Legion commander. But yeah, man, mid lane, this is where we're going to see a lot of high-flying action, or at least some intense mid lane CS work.
Yeah, a nice little bit back and forth. I think it's easier for Templar Assassin to get a good portion of this as long as he's able to control the runes. Because as long as you have mana, you have the refraction, you have that bonus right-click damage, which is just tipping you over a little bit over the Exhort. Exhort's great, but the fact that Invoker has a lower base damage, it's a little bit more difficult for him. But I think a big factor in this lane is just support rotations. If the Urshaker comes in, finds an opportunity to block out the Invoker, that's a completely different matchup than if he's able to farm just safely on his high ground. So we'll see. For now, Spirit Breaker's passive, Urshaker has been moving around a bit, but hasn't found any real threats. So for now, it's just a farm fest other than Solitude and Funnic dueling it out a little bit in the Radiant Jungle.
Yeah, because it's that time for runes. And look who's cutting him off of the passage. The Greeno trying to go. Even the last minute charge, though, helps assist.
That's not good.
Oh, that's a haste rune as well. They are going to hunt down Funnic to the end of time, and he's going to be forced to kind of get near the tower and avoid any sort of extra aggression. So he does advance that way, and Spearbreaker will take that haste back towards the bottom lane, it looks like, for now. And touching base with CS, top is going to be Havos there, as he's at 12-4 in this top lane. Necro already getting some early shots in on this tier 1 tower mid lane, though. Yeah, we got a Fisher. Oh, it's about to connect. It actually is enough to block him on out. Nice, Fisher. Long range. Wee pulls out the Ice Wall and a Spirit to slow him down, and with the assistance of Nature's Prophet, it's going to be enough to keep Dendi back, but look who's a charging home. It's going to be Spirit Breaker, puts him right in. No, Fisher in the bash. God. It's going to be W33, also known as Weeha, who gets it done in the mid lane with the first Blood Strike on Dendi.
Very, very nicely done there. I love the Fisher play. I love that spot going in and just blocking off the lane entirely. And it could have been a great setup, but quick fingers of Weeha. He brings in the Ice Wall for that Quaz Exhort. Is able to bail himself out nicely. Actually, yeah, Ford Spirit
denied.
And Ice Wall. Very quick reaction. And then, of course, they brought in the cavalry. So
Weeha is like a Pistol Pete with this Invoker. He just brings out spells so damn fast. You see a little bit of an exhibition there on the mid lane, which certainly helps him keeping Dendi away. And with the quick rotation reaction from their Nature's Prophet and company, they get a first Blood Strike on Dendi where they need it the most, because he's 9-11 right now, as far as CS, and Invoker now matches up about 9-7.
Tidehunter
is still finding a fair amount here in the bottom lane. He's 6-1. He's currently getting charged. This could be just, of course, Spirit Breaker taking the express train towards this bottom lane. So a little bit here and there, but it's still Havos getting the best out of all the lanes right now in this top lane with really no contention, because Legion Commander is already back in base.
So we'll have to see how quickly she gets to her level 6 and where they're able to go from there with it. I'm assuming a Blink Rush will be needed for Haki. He's definitely got the backup with a Heroes like Nature's Prophet and Invoker. So we're going to see actually a nice teleport in, stagger to the boundary, and actually getting this round. Funnic will Tango through, but take a lot of damage from Solitude.
That Sunstrike was so close, but not close enough, unfortunately, to finish off Funnic right there. And now Solitude. Hefty right-click coming in from Skywrath Mage. That was a little close for comfort. It would have been right on had it been over just a hair to the left-hand side, even factoring in the bash charge-in. Fortunately, it's not going to happen for them. So Spearbreaker pulls back, but it just goes to show, man, every 2 minutes we could see a big engagement. Meanwhile, speaking of which, mid lane, they get a nice catch-up here, and Weeha should fall. Ancient Seal's already happened, and just one more right-click, and it's going to be Dendi who gets redemption from
your
the earlier First Blood, taking down Weeha
I
on the mid lane.
No longer hide.
Very, very nice kill for him. He needs to get some phase boots or whatever online, so he needs some movement speed advantage, and getting that kill is going to allow him to definitely outgun the...
Oh, the Fissure catches right behind. Concussive shot. Is it enough power? It's not. Havos still running it down. The salve will be there in addition, but look, it's like Nature's Prophet will cancel the TP. Almost came in for a bit of reinforcements, but Lashrek, who did commit, there's Nature's Prophet, comes in from behind, wants to get all over Havos. Sprout's going to lock him. Sunstrike, not going to be needed, as they still take down Havos without it. So they end up returning their own kill back on this top lane. Look who's still in. Split Earth, not going to catch there, unfortunately.
Yeah, we expected this kind of high-octane action from the beginning because of the pickup of the Spirit Brave and Nature Prophet there. Heroes that have dynamic capabilities, most definitely. They're in all over the place, different lanes. You see, when it's a 1v1 between Weeha and Dendi, it really just comes down to the refraction. If that's available, Dendi is absolutely dominant. But there's been so much activity in this mid lane, it's really hard to call that as a singular matchup at this point. I will note that the Spirit Breaker did go for this Orb of Venom pickup, which I find is pretty interesting. Essentially, that the alternative choice here would be a Stout Shield instead of the Orb of Venom. The similar price, obviously, both take up one inventory slot. And with that, you'd be able to duel a lot better with the Tide, because you can block the Anchor Smash with the Stout Shield. So, I mean, that's one thing you lose, but the chasing potential. If they're off tower, you can gun down so hard, maybe get that extra bash in. Obviously, he's already contributed to some kills. So I'm interested to see how it pans out. For now, the boots are finally up, and I'm assuming he's going to charge straight up from base. There's no reason not to.
Yeah, certainly not. It could be back on Dendi. He tried it previously, but he was spotted out and quickly pulled it on off. Meanwhile, Funnik getting a lot out of this bottom lane, goes towards the pull camp on the side, does run into Weehaw here, who crosses his path and tries to take a bit of that aggro towards the bottom lane instead, but now forfeiting up that mid lane, hands it over to Levi here, who's going to try to take advantage of a little bit of solo farm, but he has to be cautious. Dendi's still there on the other side, and his Templar still bringing a respectable farm, has power treads for now, and 200 gold chalked up. Meanwhile, top lane, they might go for an engagement here on Hockey from behind. It's coming Vanscore, nice setup with the Silence. Fissure as well. Nice. Just makes for an easy Reaper scythe finish right there from Mavos, but they're going to try to grab one support at least. The charge comes in, and the Sunstrike follow-up makes it for easy pickings here. His Balkan Bears aren't going to take nothing. At the end of that, they do lose their Legion Commander offlane, but at least they get Skywrath.
Yeah, but it is a 20-second death timer turned into a 50-second death timer with the Reaper side.
Radiant's
Legion Commander
top
is not going to be hitting level 6
attack
for a very long time, and BBC don't get to realize that momentum. Like, they're building off of Sprout Sunstrikes very nicely, and the Spiritbreaker charges have been relatively on point, but this is still a hard-roaming Spiritbreaker. He's still level 3 because he doesn't dedicate himself to a lane, and they want to build off of that into some great dual damage, but till the duel
Dire's
is up, that's just not going to happen. For now,
attack.
He's
charges,
out.
He gets pinged out right there as Earthshaker does cross him, and Funnik immediately pulls back, but he might be ready to fight here. Oh, well, I guess not. Sunstrike just makes another brief combo. It's getting pretty cute, and it's working for now. Because they grab Funnik in that off lane, they should have seen it. I mean, it was FNG, I believe, yeah, who crossed the path of Spiritbreaker while charging, pinged it out, and, well, Funnik doesn't pull back in time.
Uh-oh.
Dendi.
Dendi on the hunt here. That's Pedrino. Charge is coming in. Sprouts himself. Dishes out as much right click as possible before he does go down. And now Levi's going to be on the chase, and so is Spiritbreaker still. Full charge forced. And they're going to try to catch up with her. Still, it looks like. Oh, nice slow with the Lightning Storm. Sets up for this. Sunstrike again. It's going to be right there. It's Weehaw. Beautifully done once more. With that charge setup, he just gets the easy Sunstrike landing right on top of the head of Dendi and gets the kill from the bottom where he's currently dancing with Funnik.
Yeah, I feel like he's run this combo
Radiant's
quite a bit
top
before. It just seems like
attack.
One of those kind of a very simple, hey, go in this guy, I got Sunstrike ready. You can alt-click that and you can communicate that. So it seems like a very good pub strat, and it's translating well into this competitive match. I mean, going in here, I would say that Na'Vi have overstepped their bounds a couple times, like the Funnik. Like you mentioned, he probably underestimated the potential of Spiritbreaker with Invoker. Fissure will come out. They do have the Ravage.
They might use it here. Weehaw's got a decent bounty. He Sunstrikes himself, but a nice step back there from Funnik, but the charge is still coming. He's got plenty of life. Nature's
Dire's
Prophet shows up with a global presence. Sprouts Dendi very nicely, and Weehaw is in the clear for the time being. Charging on through, though, is going to be your Spiritbreaker making it go on Funnik, but company's there, and they now turn their sights to Solitude. Solitude is going to be able to step away. Nice sprout again from Nature's Prophet. Locks Dendi in his tree cage. And this allows Balkan Bears to pull on back and away from any sort of danger. Arcane Bolt will fly, and he'll just chase him all the way towards the base, however.
And then up top, Necrophos was taken down there. It was a duel given to the Legion Commander, so just a combination of Levy and Haki. Using the left track, Legion Commander
back on bottom. Solitude might be caught, but there's that charge. Works fantastic as a nice little escape mechanism as well. Just simply charges out a creep in the mid lane or what have you, and he just gets on out of there before Na'Vi can really grab a hold of him. So
Radiant's
while they're getting work done on the bottom lane, they place
out
a nice little aggressive ward to scout out
Dire's
the BBC jungle. Step back and maybe try to finish this tier 1 tower if possible. But Nature's Prophet's already here, bringing up a nice defense.
Yeah. It's an interesting pickup from Haki here. He actually goes for the Soul Ring. It is going to allow him to use Press Attack very frequently on himself, so he'll gain that health back. But it is an 800 gold investment that takes away from potential Blink Daggers. Personally, I prefer just occasionally go back to Well to fuel up and use my full mana combo there. But you get some more spam, you get to be more active on the map, and we'll see how it works out for him.
All right, look who's charging in. Spiritbreaker, thinking he can open up here on Havos. Will pull off. for committing too hard, but it's only 12 seconds, so it's going to be 8 more seconds. So he'll have it about up, ready to go. They get a few hits in on this tier 1 tower mid lane. It's going to be a Fisher that comes out to zone back. Anyone nearby, let them know. We're here. We're ready to take this tower. Levy's right there. Pulls out Lightning Storm. Nice Earth Splitter. Does catch, or Split Earth, rather, from Levy, and they take down Dendi. Just like that. And meanwhile, on the bottom river, yeah, they get a hold of Funnik with a nice Sprout. Let's pull out the Treant. He gets one last Acre Smash, but that's not going to be enough as a defense. And another kill gets picked up from BBC, and it's going to be Solitude who gets it.
Yeah, so that's a nice single out. I mean, Ty just keeps on walking around with way too low HP. Funnik made a really cool move with a sidestep of a Sunstrike earlier, and I think that he has great nap sense, but in general, this game he has been too far gone with too low HP. That's just a fact of life here. But in the end, he does go down twice, but he's going to be able to rubber band back on.
Dendi gets stunned as he TP's in. Is trying to take care of Levi here, or Levy. Takes him to the high ground. One big strike. Fisher's going to be there. Meanwhile, Spirit Breaker actually takes out Vanskor behind them. And that quickly pulls them back. He gets what he wants. He steps out from the jungle on the northern side. And nothing is going to happen here on mid. Not for now, at least.
Havos dropping very low here. He has the stats and melting strikes.
Oh, Sprout, he quickly eats his way out of that one, but back on mid lane, we might see an engagement. Dendi gets the slow off, but charging on through a Spirit Breaker right towards Earthshaker, and he quickly takes him down. It's going to be Haki who gets it done with the long-range nuke, and now Solitude. Nice little juke away from the trap right there. Oh, ultimate going to be denied from the Ancient Seal coming out from Vanskor. Bit of redemption from him, previously being taken down in the jungle, but Yeehaw here, bottom lane, Havost. A little bit of early damage. Fisher's going to be there. He has the no ultimate available. Weehaw trying to slow. Even pulls out the ice wall here. He might get away from this one. Long range hit's going to be there, and Havos gets it done.
Look at that Sadus regen just kicking in. Full mana, vast majority of his HP, and they can just push off of this easily. The Nature Prophet actually tried to go for a cheeky play
Radiant's
when
bottom
there was 10
attack.
Melting Strike stacks up on Havos. The Nature Prophet jumps in, tries to go for the kill, but finds himself caught out 1v1 against the Necrobos in the trees, and
Radiant's
that's where the Reaper Scythe finishes
fallen.
Him off. So the Nature Prophet has been down for a very long period of time, and they take the tier 1 off of that.
They go back, they start farming out the enemy territory now, taking away anything from BBC that they can. Lovey makes his return to the bottom. He's got Arcanes, he's got Soul Ring, the early investment into a Bloodstone, I would imagine, here on your Lashrek, which we've seen played in a core position role before in the hands of, can't say Wisps, Musica pulled out a fantastic Lashrek during the Summit 2C region earlier. But here we go, bottom lane. It's going to be Na'Vi here, kind of flirting with the Roche Pit, getting rid of a couple Treants, but with that intel is BBC, and they're in the neighborhood. They're maybe thinking about some way to kind of contest this. Man, oh man. Stepping back now is Na'Vi. I think they're starting to build a little bit more respect for the unique draft and team put together of BBC.
Yeah, they have a lot of pickoff potential, but that's just it. If Na'Vi go 5-man right now, there's not much that will stop them. Funnik has Blink Ravage available. They've got all these chain heals from Necrophos, who has now acquired a soul booster, and I really don't think that single target play is going to cut it anymore. Like, you might be able to single out one person if they go 4-man movement to push or to Roche, and then another's farming to try to be efficient. But other than those minor pickoffs here and there, Na'Vi have the better 5-man right now, and they're certainly making it known. They just walk right into the pit. Even if it's scouted out, I think they're confident to take the first round.
They have company waiting up in the balcony wing nearby to hop on in with their big team impact in case it will be contested. Funnik feels pretty confident, though, will move himself in there, maybe seeing if they'll kind of bite the bullet then, but Treon is already moving up and behind to see if there's going to be anyone waiting. It is going to be a Shaker, and of course, Vanskor's Skywrath Mage, but it's taking a long time to take this down. I mean, Roche is still only at about a quarter life down.
Dyer's
now Dendi really
beginning
to push in those right clicks. But nearby, you can see Weehaw gets a hold of Funnik here. Might go on a one-on-one adventure. Those four spirits, heavy damage. It's going to actually force out
Dyer's
the Ravage defensively for him
to get
away from this one. And Weehaw starts doubling back towards the Roche Pit, where you see charge coming in from Spirit Breaker, but it blows up back in his face. The Reaper Scythe secures the kill for Havos right there. But now jumping out through is going to be Haki. Gets a hold of Rain here, and now Meow Meow. Vanskor gets caught out very quickly. Dendi, big Echo Slam, return fire from FNG. But they're still on the hunt. Dendi real low here as Havos tries to walk away. The ice wall keeps him so low, and he's sprouted up as well. He eats himself from the other side, goes towards the Funic Smoke even to try to give a little bit of extra move speed, but it's not going to be there and available. And they're not done yet, man. They're going to huddle way across. They're pinging out exactly where Havost is. They're sending the Ford Spirits in and the Treants now to scout him out in the corner. But by now, everyone's coming back to life. They're going to TP right back into lane. FNG. Fissure will lock Levi. Keep calling him Levi. It's their Levy. Tries to force that up into blood, but we'll pull out the TP. We'll make it on out. Nature's Prophet puts himself. We'll get another TP to make his way out. And I have to say, man, I think Balcon Bears really came out big there.
Yeah.
Bush was not taken. They got a couple of nice pickoffs and took out Havost.
I would say there's just so many shenanigans going on right now. Like, the aspect of that Evoker finding this almost solo pickoff on Funnic, forcing him to be running Naked Blink to go for the self-ravage to save himself, means they didn't have control over the pit. Haki didn't get the duel. It didn't give it up either.
Oh, man, it just doesn't stop. Now there's a big breakout here in the bottom of the river. It's Spiritbreaker gets caught out with a very nice Mystic Flare. Now a duel comes onto the field. They take down Skywrath Mage. The duel does end, and Legion Commanders falls. They split the fight. Dendi so low, unable to get away. He's trying to. He's going off to the right-hand side, but meanwhile, in the pit, a blink off from Fun. It gets him away from any extra engagement. FNG sprouted up, turns back with a Fissure, where Dendi's trying to do big damage, but he's eating a lot from the trees that can remove his refraction. They can continue going on the retreat up to the north. And Havost has finally showed up, but here he comes. He sees Lashraki, turns back in, and they're still making it happen. Coming in from behind is going to be Funic, who's got about 16 more seconds for Ravage. Doesn't need it. Pulls out Anchor Smash. Now Funic's on a killing spree. Throws out a Gush here on Weeha, and I think BBC are going to finally need to pull back at this point.
Yeah, they lost their tempo. Legion Commander was looking for a quick, easy duel. The Sunstrike almost facilitates it, but they clump up on it. They distribute the damage, and in the end, they don't get the kill they're looking for. A lot of duels have come out. Only two of them have actually ended with a win. And the duel lasted a long time now. 4.75 seconds at level 2 on the ultimate. It's going to be longer and longer, and eventually the duel will end with somebody getting some damage. But as you're mentioning, Levi or Levy is going to pick up that Bloodstone. And he's going to have a lot of durability to him. Like, even if he gets hit by the Reaper Scythe, the current charge of the Bloodstone will just about nullify that. Like, that's actually pretty comparable. 32 seconds versus 30.
Yeah.
8 stacks of Bloodstone will nullify the effect of the Reaper Scythe as far as taking him out of the action, but it's more about the active stats that bring him into the fray. The mana that he gets to play around with. He only has 1 point in ultimate, but probably will get another point very soon, and he really does need to sustain that to really see the full potential of his damage output.
Dendi's smoked up. He's going to be on the high ground here. He scouts out Spirit Breaker, and now he's going to start dishing in the damage. Saltu has nowhere to go. Dendi's just standing in front of him like, you're not going to make it past me, buddy. Coming in from behind is an additional Fissure from FNG, and just makes for an easy pickoff right there with a good use of a smoke coming out. Dendi picks himself up. Nice little kill.
Oh, Petrino's going to go down. Havost gets two Death Pulses and gets in the more than he gets inside the Sprout. He didn't have any tree cutters, but he just gets in literally melee range of this Nature's Prophet before he tries to go for the Sprout TP. So two Death Pulse, one Reaper Scythe, and that's a Furion out down for the count for another minute. So that's going to be plenty of time for Dendi to farm up, for them to just build up their forces, and for them to continue to accrue momentum. I mean, 10 stacks on Necrophos' Bloodstone, and he's just looking to ramp that up even further.
Nice,
and Funic's got a Ring of Health. Do you think he's going to go for the Bloodstone again?
I don't know. It's hard to say at this point. I mean, he's been taken down a notch, and the farm isn't as assertive as it was in that game. It could be just the early makings of his refresher, I think. I don't think this is going to be the same kind of game where they're going to have to worry too much about being able to bounce back quickly, but really, who am I to judge? He might have thrown together a new innovative build that he feels works out nicely, and he could just build on it from there. So we'll have to find out eventually. But if somehow BBC, man, these supports, like, can it somehow bring in some serious cash flow, Solitude being able to throw together like a BKB would just be so huge for the Spiritbreaker to get a lot more done in these fights. Because right now he kind of charges in, and he gets hit with the bad end of a Mystic Flare usually, and just kind of gets taken down immediately. He doesn't really have a whole lot going for him aside from an urn, but still, look at this, flirting by the Roche Pit. Levy letting him know with a split earth that we see you doing this, Roche. Roche still has a quarter life to work with for now. And now they're going to catch out on the high ground and take down the Earthshaker. Funic very low inside the pit, waits and faints with the Ravage, pulls it on out. They bring home a Levi, and they do manage to take him down. Duel's going to catch here on Funic, however, in exchange. LC takes out the return. Fire 4, they also finish off Havos with a nice nuke, and now they put themselves into the pit and will take out Roche themselves.
Really big. Really big to take out the Echo Slam from the equation. And honestly, they minimized the impact of Phonic Gravity. They had a good spread out here. Phonic was penned in. By going for this Naked Blink, the second that he takes player base damage and that gets put on cooldown, he's not really that great. Like, he takes so much damage as his armor gets penetrated by the Melting Strikes, and he actually has been in a situation so many times this game where Dire's it's a Ravage or bust. Like, he either dies and gets a, and doesn't get the Ravage off at all, or he puts out a bad Ravage. So in this situation, it's not looking great for Na'Vi, at least for this 10-minute period. I still think they have better late-game potential, but at least for right now, BBC have finally finished the mechanism on Pedrino. They get the Aegis up on the...
Double damage!
Okay, and Weehouse got it. And he's going to pick up a Necro 3 very soon.
Fearbreaker at least gets power treads. Denied. Getting a little bit more meat on the bone, something he certainly needs as his initiator. And great spot out by there from BBC to take out that Earthshaker on the cliff. Allows them to feel a little more comfortable with making an advancement into the Roche Pit, which they take full advantage of. Now, bottom lane, Weehaw's been doing a lot of his work down here, split pushing on his Invoker, constantly finding farm for himself and only really coming into these heated engagements when necessary. He's looking to enhance that even further as he already has Necro 2 here. His side push is going to get ridiculous real quick, and it's something that Na'Vi are going to have to consider here.
Yeah. I do have to correct one thing that I was asking about earlier. The Ring of Health, I actually forgot for a moment that the Soul Ring is the Codent, not the Perseverance. So you can't build Bloodstone out of that one anymore. But he does go for this Pipe, which is actually my second favorite option.
Oh! They commit an Echo Slam to take down the Shrek, but Spirit Breaker's right in there to get a little bit of something back. And they do take down Skywrath Mage, but Nature's Prophet also committed for this one. Might be caught out. Sunstrike, not going to matter as Earthshaker ends up falling regardless. And there, they also managed to bring down your Spirit Breaker, make it a 3-for-2, but still dancing back and forth is Weehaw, who they're now making advancement on with the Blink Gush. He's forced to pull out the Ice Wall and Force Staff to get away from this one and will be able to. Now Na'Vi with a slight advantage in numbers, and with their two cores in this mid lane, they can finish off this tier
Radiance
one.
Middle tower is under
so
attack.
They're definitely going to be taking that, no problem at all. And
Radiant structures are fortified.
Which isn't good against almost any hero but the Leshrac. Like the Wrath of Nature and stuff, yeah. But...
Oh, jump in duel. Going to be saved, though, from that Ravage, and it's going to be damage awarded because of that towards Necro and the Reaper Scythe. Going to get a hold of Leshrac. This is unfortunate here. BBC had a brief advantage there momentarily, but now mid lane implodes on them after losing the tier one and going for a dual advancement. They don't count on the fact that Funnick was right there. But speaking of which, ooh, Charge is going to be canceled the last second. Funnick's not done yet. Blinks forward even with no mana. Thinking he can go for some sort of anchor smash and approach, but it's not going to be there. But man, oh man, him to save the day with a very nice Ravage that allows Havos to just inherit a little bit of bonus damage.
Yeah, this is nice. I mean, getting the Reaper Scythe off, so that's a big win against the Leshrac. Essentially, they're Bloodstone brothers from across the factions here. Each of them are running the Bloodstone. They're taking charges off of one another every time the other gets killed, and that's important. Right here, the Necrophos getting the huge respawn timer advantage, as well as the AoE heal, which is something I think that a lot of people underrate. But for Dendi, getting in the thick of things, if he's down low HP, and we can see Havos heal him up with not only the Death Pulse, but potentially his own death, that could be really, really potent. So anyways, Pronounce going to be regen rune up for TA, but Dyer's walking into a really bad spot here. A simple cold snap, and he's done for. He does have haste, but they have to lock him.
And they turn back. They pull off the charge for now. Refraction is now going to be taken down. They quickly focus fire Dendi, trying to take him apart, and they will get him. Very nice grab. It's going to be Weehaw who benefits from it. And those Forge Spirits, man, dishing out huge right-click damage at this point. They get the nice pickoff right there. They take themselves towards this top lane, but Spirit Breaker, he's already onto his next target. He's charging on through, scouts out FNG, which runs him face first into a Fissure. Negative Earn gets thrown on out, and with the rotation from TP,
NP,
ooh, thinks about
attack.
The Sprout there, but it ends up right behind Havost. They return fire, nice! Weehaw catches the Sunstrike attack. Right there onto Skywrath Mage, but meanwhile, up and above, the Reaper Scythe is what's gonna take out Nature's Prophet. Now, Spirit Breaker and LC making their way out from the opponent's jungle. Same with Levy here. They lose two in exchange for two.
Radiant's bottom tower is under attack.
So, yeah, I mean, very active back and forth fights, obviously. It's hard to say who's 100% ahead just because there are so many splits of the fights. Like, they're it's hard to say this skirmish led to this skirmish led to this skirmish, but there is a lot of cause and effect here, and there is a lot going on. For now, I think the fact that Legion Commander has accumulated 34 dual damage is nice, but I don't think it's the quota she was looking for here. Along with that, we see a lot of survivability coming up for Havos now. They've got a pipe for the entire team, which again is mostly for the Leshrac's purposes. Like, Meteor and Wrath of Nature do quite a bit of magic damage, but this Death Pulse is what you're afraid of. So that's what you get the pipe for, and obviously the PKB just nullifies all that entirely. Even the Blade Mail damage is nullified. So Havos has a lot of potential here with the BKB to not only survive through the fight, but to thrive. He's got plus 14 damage, he's got the Reaper Scythe maxed out, which means its cooldown is down to 70 seconds, and although I feel like it's kind of been wishy-washy, both sides gaining the upper hand in some aspects of the game, I think that's about to turn. I think Na'Vi, if they group together, if they play as a team, they have the better items to win this game.
We'll see if they'll be able to pull it together. BBC, a hungry, literally hungry group. It's looking to try to wrap this one up so they can move on through their day. Lots of Dota ahead of them, as with all of us here. Still pulling out a nice admirable effort early on. Taking advancement in kills 22-0. Weehawk constant pressure globally as well. Pinpoint accuracy with his Sunstrikes, it seems, even on the back end of the fray when you see supports trying to just sneak their way out. They end up running face first into a strike from above. And it's Weehawk who's delivering it. Meanwhile, he'll just keep pressuring and side pushing on out with that Necro 3 already in hand. And near 1,500 gold, we'll have to see what he decides to invest for next. Do you think he could consider something like a Sheepstick? A little bit extra lockdown certainly doesn't hurt too much when going against someone like, you know, your Dendi and your Havos, who have yet to, you know, I mean, Dendi at least needs to finish out his BKB. Havos has his already, but I don't know. Do you think something to add a bit more to the side push, like an AC or something, or does he keep Sheepstick?
That's a tough one. Right now, I think the lockdown would be really nice, and Dendi is not, doesn't have his BKB yet, but he's working on it. And the problem is, right now, you're dealing with full capacity BKBs. It's about to be two 10-second BKBs, and unless you open really nicely with that, you're just going to get ravaged anyways, and you're probably going to be limited in the value you get out of that one. So, I don't know. At this point, there's so many items that he needs, and not one will solve all his problems. But Sheepstick, probably a good start, because it does enhance what they're trying to do, which is solo pickoffs.
Meanwhile, farming in the enemy jungle is a key. Taking away a little bit of farm here and there. Na'Vi also kind of playing a little more hesitant. Dendi was kind of being the lone ranger for scouting at the enemy side. And he's back home, and there's going to be a gen grab right now from Vanskor. After pulling out a smoke, they're going to head right through the enemy woods, do a sweep to make sure no one's still hanging nearby and go for any possible dewarding and keep control on their side of the map at least, so they don't have any sort of lingering BBC members who are trying to go for a pickoff play. And they're sweeping towards Weeha up here in the top lane, and they're going to catch Levy on the way. Fissure, Mystic Flare, and Goatman goes down immediately. Like it's nothing, just a sweet appetite for them. Taking advantage
nice
of that smoke
though,
rotation.
He doesn't get Reapered, which means he's actually going to be back up in time for like to maybe defend the tier 2. Oh, Weeha doesn't get picked anyways. Oh my god.
That play from Weeha. Saw that they were all nearby and still wanted to hang out. And ultimately they get a vision of him and they just jump in and take him out.
Dendi dropping low. He has double damage and BKB up right now, but won't be able to find any finishers. And he was actually under a lot of pressure there. They commit the Nether Strike, rock him with the physical, or the piercing, magic immunity piercing disables and damage, and almost bring him down. But still, he stands. The refraction keeps him up, and they go in for the push.
Dendi has DD with still half duration left.
Radiant's middle tower
almost came
is under
near.
Attack.
Brief glimpse of seeing the LC farming nearby, but they're looking to advance on forward, get a hold of this tier 2 tower while Invoker is still down for like another 30 seconds. Lestrak's about to get back up and made good use of that Bloodstone earlier, but only down to 2 charges now, as it's going to be a little bit before he can build up a little bit of extra points and get to a point when they could be able to have the immediate respawn timer. Going against the Necro, of course, makes it that much sweeter, but for now, they're just kind of pushing on pretty hard right here. We are obviously going to have a bit of a pause, as it looks like there's going to be a bit of a moment here for the Valkyr Bears to kind of recoup, but I have to say, still looking very strong right now. On the side of Na'Vi, Funic, after picking up that pipe, he's got a staff now, Wizardry. I imagine this is just going to be invested into a force staff for a little more mobility. Another step away from getting that refresher, but still, Na'Vi very confident in their team fight.
Yeah. I mean, there is some value in an item like Eulaceptor on a Tide. You can still just maneuver a little bit better. He's been pinned down really hard by things like just Cold Snap, Right Click coming in from the Invoker. And yeah, it might help. But I think Force Staff is probably the better bailout tool because he knows the Hex is going to be coming from the Invoker. And he might be able to just push the victim out of a bad spot a little bit easier. So Force is probably what you're looking at there. Beyond that, finally, of course, we see the Blink Dagger on Earthshaker, so some even better slams. We saw the one up in the Dire Jungle. That was pretty solid. By the way, somebody's mentioning if you can turn your mic down a little bit. I think it might be like the game sounds and my own are a little bit lower, but I think it's fairly close.
No problem. I can turn down my jam a little bit right now. That doesn't seem to be too much effort. Appreciate for letting me know in such a calm, respective manner, but I think it's better now, hopefully. It's not too quiet to you, right? Does it sound a little bit lower?
It is lower, but it is good.
All right, hopefully it's okay. I'll put the mic a little bit away from my mouth so I'm not screaming to people's ears, of course. But a lot of the games today have been so clowny and pretty ridiculous, it's hard to not go from like 0 to 100 at any point in any game. Even for this one, man, they're lining up some fantastic Sunstrikes. It's a very unorthodox lineup with already Spirit Breaker, and it's BBC. We're finding all these great pickoffs, but Na'Vi, cool comp collected. Well-versed team that has a lot of veteran experience. They're not going to be too shaked up by any sort of crazy Spirit Breaker play, and I think they have their eyes on the prize, and they're going for it right now down the mid lane.
Yeah, so some nice little talk back and forth. In the lobby, Havos was mentioning an airplane, so maybe he has a flight that he has to catch or something. Yeah. So everybody wants this game to go underway, for sure, guys. They aren't paused for no reason. As soon as they get everything calibrated as they need to, then they'll be good to go, and it looks like Havos makes the call in that regard. So right now, with the fact that there's a 10-second BKB and a 13-stack Bloodstone on the Necrophos, he's looking damn fine. But there's still the solo pickoff. I think that's what they need. Oh, speaking of solo pickoffs, just before the pause, Pedrino teleported here. The Dire Observer kind of reaches there. I think he actually might have been envisioned of it, but
middle
either way, they make quick work of him with just one stun to initiate.
Radiant structures are fortified.
Place to kind of show up. Doesn't work out too well for him. He immediately gets taken down before we can even scout out what the hell's actually happening. And without dropping a beat,
Dire's
it looks like Na'Vi can continue
under attack.
Putting in the effort here mid lane. Finally, Weehaw going to be back up and alive right now.
Radiant's middle tower
I think they
is
can finish
attack.
What they started on this tier 2 tower, and they're just going to have to wait it out. Hockey's lingering nearby. He does have his blink. Duel ready to go. Puts the amplification on himself. Jumps forward, but they also scout out Weehaw, who came in from behind, and he goes down immediately again. Blink and duel catches
Dire's
on Funic. But his allies are right there to bring back Hefty. Right click, he goes down. It's not going to be quick enough to get bonus damage towards the favor of your Tidehunter, but BBC tried to go for a blitzy play there in the mid lane, and it does not work out.
Attack.
I don't know where the heck Weehaw came in from, but he tried to go in from behind, and with the boots of travel, that's not going to cut it. He gets caught out and immediately taken apart.
These flanking plays, I mean, they can do well when you have a numbers advantage, but that's the opposite of what we were looking at there. The Nature Prophet getting picked off. You looked at Nature Prophet as a hero that he can often bring two full lives to every single team fight if he needs to with the global teleport. That's how Alliance used to run him all the time, is always having that buyback available. And obviously, we've seen buyback nerfs, but still the Nature Prophet rings strong in that regard for the most part. But because he hasn't had the best of times, I mean, his net worth is only at 7.9k, and the fact that he gets Reaper Scythe, he is zero heroes for a team fight. So jumping into that one when Dire clearly have the Observer Ward advantage, it just it seemed like it cost them too much, and it's downhill from here, really. The Aegis comes out for the Templar Assassin. She's looking for a Desolator next. Dendi is getting big, and Havos is already there. He's ready to just go chomp on the front line and bring this one down.
And for BBC, this is pretty much just could be a Calm. Huge uphill Calm. Climb at this point, and a game that where even a win wouldn't matter a whole lot. I imagine that they're just going to get more and more rambunctious here, and when it becomes closer to the point where you got to go for an all or nothing, I think they're going to have no hesitation in trying to go for a blitzy kind of a play. But for now, Nature's Prophet puts himself towards the bottom lane to add some side pressure here with a little bit of split push. They're going to go ahead and leave behind for now what looks like Solitude to kind of bring in some intel and scout out exactly what the hell's happening. They place down this aggressive Obs Ward to kind of see, well, it was there. And now with that gem, of course, they're going to quickly take it apart. So Na'Vi just keeping control in their own jungle. And Spearbreaker, who's still hanging nearby here, is going to see Na'Vi squad kind of rotate through towards this top lane where Tier 1's still standing. There was a Sunstrike. I don't think it's going to do a whole lot. But still, they're going to push out from above and take out this Tier 1 tower.
Radiant's top tower is under attack.
I don't know what that is about, but Yeah, we're going and seeing some nice Radiant's push come through. Spiritbreaker hiding is going to cut through Dyer's the creep wave. Also, we saw, of course, the Nation Prophet doing some good split push down bottom. Now it's Weehaw with him. So Greeno and Weehaw combine together, take attack. That tier 2. But we're going to see a huge Echo Slam off of all those Treants and Void Spirits.
Wow. Yeah. Well, that was Earthshaker setting it up for the spike coming out from Funnic at the end there. And that was a quick two-man takedown like it was nothing. Just a nice simple setup with one R slam to another. That's the dream right there.
I mean, they lose a tower, but this is going to give them the easy tier 3 push. Dendi won't be forced to use his Aegis too early on unless he starts diving. He does have his Blink Blade Mail, though, and some members have to be careful. If the Refraction's gone or if the BKB's not there, Necro, either one of them could be in some trouble. We're going to see the Blink, the duel. Will they be able to bring it down?
They hold the boss in place. Big Mystic Flare, but the Blade Mail fires back huge damage and takes out Skywrath Mage. Havos had already fallen with a big BKB or a big Bloodstone. He'll come right back, but it's Dendi now. Bringing out huge damage to take out the LC. Dancing back is going to be your Lashrek, who has to move on forward. If he gets hit again with a big, big strike, he could go down. But here they go, Dendi right from behind. BKB popped to prevent the fissure, but it's not going to prevent that click. Dendi cleans him up very easily.
Oh, he's stuck! The fissure actually blocked him.
Locked him in place, and he goes down.
And I don't think he actually gets out. Like, this is there are a lot of spells being cast upon him, and yeah, they just don't have a bailout to us. That is actually a full death for Dendi, losing the Aegis to his own ally's Fissure. That's kind of brutal. It was really cool to see him swap on the Courier, to get the Desolator out real quick, and get that 1-2 punch on Leshrac, but at what cost?
He's up to the high ground. They do scout out Funnic, but Funnic promptly blinks away when he sees aggression coming in. And yeah, that's a nice little grab there on Dendi. Does take him down a peg, but still has plenty of money to invest. He can do a buyback if necessary, but obviously it would not be. Havos back from his recent departure. He's got his Shivas now on hand, and now an Ogre Club. So it looks like he kind of stepped off the path a little bit and got a whole little bit of extra armor for himself. And with this Ogre Club, I think that's the only basis of an Agnum Scepter. So if he gets anyone with his ultimate at this point, no buyback going to be coming out. It's going to be that much easier for them to kind of put a lid on the game.
Yeah, the Ags is going to be huge. I mean, the only way to actually end this game is to make sure that they're down for the count and they are not buying back. And so, although the net worth really hasn't been favoring BBC, and thus it's unlikely for them to have buyback in the first place, we still look at it. We see Invoker and Legion Commander both have it available, and that's because of the turnaround kill on Dendi, getting so much rubber band gold out of the 6.82-esque gold changes. The bounty is huge, and yeah, they've still got a lot banked up. They still want to find this BKB and Legion Commander, so she's probably going to buy out for that. And I guess then Reaper Scythe debuff wouldn't be that big of a deal. But even if it's only just for the coefficient increase, obviously the Aghanim Scepter enhances the damage that the Reaper Scythe does by from 0.9 to 1.2 per point of missing HP. I still think it's a valuable pickup, and it's very important for them to have towards the mid to late game.
They're charging in on Dendi, and they pull out just before they get there, creating a little bit of space, it looks like, for now, but Snavi, who are slowly creeping in the bottom lane, is under attack. The worm on the hook, see if anyone wants to make a jump with Funnic nearby, and Radiant's Blink and Ravage ready to go, and just behind that, Vanskor, slamming Mystic Flare. But they're not going to need to do anything. Havos is just going to be able to singularly take out this tier 2 tower while BBC continue to add pressure up and above. You see, there's an Echo again. Catches very nicely on Leshrac. The Wombo comes in with the Reaper Scythe, and it's going to be Dendi who slams it home with the big finish off right there. They only take down Levy in the meantime. They'll sweep through and see if they can get anyone else on the way out, but they're not already on the retreat. It's going to be BBC out from this top lane. So after the takedown on bottom with that tier 2, quickly Havos makes his move to the top lane. They end up taking out at least one Leshrac.
Yeah, it's a nice little pickup there. His Bloodstone is very sad right now. Starting out at 8 charges and going down to 1. He's not really getting too much value out of that. Like, essentially, the way I look at it is that now he has an active suicide, and he has all the stats of a soul booster and a perseverance all in one, like in one item slot. But as far as the other components, the heal and stuff like that, it's practically non-existent when you have this few of charges.
All right, now BBC feel a little bit of pressure coming their way, especially down this mid lane. And the stun's going to land here. Reno will go down. He gets his Necro Book off at least. He's going to try to get him back to base. Nope, that Archer not going to be so lucky. A little bit of extra gold there for Dendi after already taking down the NP. And now they can just kind of start making a move into the
Radiant's
high ground.
Radiant's middle tower is under attack.
With Ravage, he's tickling at the idea of making a jump in. He saw his brother Earthshaker do a big Echo Slam top lane, and he's just itching to make a big impact himself, but already sieging a lot from the low ground. Navier getting in. Weehaw's split pushing, meanwhile,
Radiant's
bottom lane
tower
slowly creeping into the high ground, trying to get some split push on their own right, but now Rax is exposed.
Dire's bottom
on the mid lane, BBC,
enough
to force back Lucid Navi here to prevent them from losing anything inside the base. They just quickly clean up those Force Spirits, those creeps, and Weehaw makes himself into the trees and TP's back to the top lane.
Still no Rax. That's the big deal here, is once Rax builds momentum, whatever team acquires them should be able to close the game out nicely off of that. Until then, I think Navi are hesitating and waiting for that refresh orb. Finally, Funnik is going to be picking it up. I think that the Blink Dagger and Pipe were good transitional items, but eventually you need to get the mana item, aka the Force Staff, in order to get enough mana to support the refresh orb, which is going to be coming up soon. But as we talked about that, Weehaw's Hex does come through, and as far as four staffs go, they do have two to counteract it to an extent. They have the Earthshaker and the Tide, who can both bail out any Hex targets if they're nearby.
Double damage!
Navi sweep from bottom to top now, moving up towards the river. They scout out and see that a Solitude Spirit Breaker is nearby. They get the gist that BBC could be up in their neck of the woods now. They don't have what looks like any sort of proper vision in their own woods. They don't. Looking to go on in. Funnik gets a little bit of a creepage in here, bringing it in, but this more timid play coming out from both sides. This could very well be a bit of a stalemate from both sides until Roche does pop back up, and we could see a possible engagement there. As Navi sweeped on through the bottom, they could get some wards down on the way if they wanted to, just to get some extra vision. Buy this Roche pit if necessary, but for now, they're just more continuing to press on down bottom. Uh-oh. Levy. They jump in, forced to pull out the BKB, and he's got to run away from this one, but Dendi is on the hunt, and with a Desolator, it's only going to take about 5-6 shots, and see you later, goat man.
For heresies,
Dendi picks up another one.
The temple decreed
your death.
Yeah,
zero Bloodstone charges now. I mean, if he doesn't die in the fight, he just has gotten nothing. He's down to 7 seconds on his BKB, he's down to 0 charges on his Bloodstone. Like, the farm that they put into this hero, it's okay in the context that Leshrac can actually carry a lot better than a lot of people expect. Oh,
yeah, we're going big on Havost right now, and it's enough to take him down. Havost, not with the team that's busy on bottom, gets caught out top, and they just manhandle him there with Weehaw pulling out the Forge Spirits, pulling out the Necro Book. They just pincer him down and take it home with Spearbreaker locking him in place. It's a good setup, and they do take out the precious Havost core here top. I don't know if Belkan Bears are going to look to make anything happen on the back end of this one, but regardless,
it's
another kill their way.
Note that he did suicide. Mm-hmm. Net worth hero on a 10,000 net worth advantage team is not giving that rubber band gold back to BBC.
No, sir.
That would be devastating. But the suicide comes out, and it's just going to be a loss of charges and a little bit of loss of time.
It does certainly work out pretty nicely. If you have such a huge early advantage of farm, like let's say how Funnik got a hold of that Bloodstone, that if you're worried once you carry a big, big bounty, you just have that suicide to fall back on just to prevent handing over so much gold in the rubber band. So, I like that little note right there. Or this recent patch where rubber band could just be such a huge thing.
Roshan has fallen into the Dire.
It's going to be Navi who creep into the pit with that, and they grab a quick and easy Roche grab. It's going to be put into the pocket of Dendi on his TA, cleaning up the current. Treon Protector will continue to farm it on up, but it's all Navi all day still. Even with Havost falling recently, he has plenty of gold, 3.2k. Going to hold plenty of it in reserve for his buyback, but eventually we'll see Navi come together, I would imagine, and go for a push towards the base with this extra life. But and as well as now a refresher picked up on Funnik. That's two Ravages. Very good.
Watermelon to the watermelon. We're looking for some big team fight. Navi have everything they need to end the game right now. I mean, yes, they could farm more. Yes, they could spread the map control and everything like that. But with BOTs and Necro 3 and Forge on the Invoker, he's still going to be ratting. He's still going to be avoiding fights as much as possible. Unless you pick him off within a minute, just go brute force down the mid lane. There's no way they hold against double Ravage when they've only got two BKBs. They just have too much invested in all these other heroes. One Reaper Scythe and they're done. So we'll see them just go right in. No chance to worry about Panda. Watch these rocks just drop to the Desolator.
Immediately pull out the glyph. And in desperation mode, you see Dyer's the Shrek top lane split pushing it home. He's got the tier 3 down relatively low, but they've already lost one Rax mid lane. And they're about to lose another. But Falcon Bear knows it's all or nothing. Dyer's race time, boys. They pull out a Necro book as well, top lane. It's going to force out the glyph at least. They finish up what they started mid lane, taking on the glyphs, and it's going to be Legion Commander trying to stop a couple of the TPs if possible on the way out. And meanwhile, bottom lane, it's going to be Weehawk trying to clean up his tier 3. Has to force back and away as Dendi makes his approach with his BKB popped. Trying desperately to stop these creeps from taking the tier 3, but it's so low. 30, 10, one more auto attack.
Manscore is going to go down to the duel in the mid lane here. They did TP and charge on top of him, so he can only escape so far. And in this case, I believe he canceled his TP to get the Yules on the Legion Commander so that they wouldn't be able to interrupt the Tide or anybody like that. So in the end, Dendi just goes man mode here. He's got the Aegis. He knows what he can accomplish with it. And yeah, he has absolutely no fear, even without the BKB.
So for the trade, Na'Vi finish out all of mid lane, taking down the set of racks. While it's just a simple two tier 3s that fall on the side of Na'Vi's base. And Falcon Bears, I guess for now, it just kind of gives them another little bit of a economy update for themselves, but still, it's all Na'Vi in this one. Still near the 10k mark in their favor. BBC, they need to consider pulling out an all-or-nothing play, I would assume, at this point, but question is if do they have the formula to make some big comeback play now? Spearbreaker charging, I imagine, just towards the lane. Yep, not on anyone just yet, but man, oh man, I'm sure Phonic is just itchy to put to work two Ravages, man.
Yeah, but the third BKB coming out for BBC does help. Welcome Bears are able to nullify the Ravages, or at least one of the Ravages, and then force Phonic to take a bit of time out there, 8 to 10 seconds before the second one pops. And yeah, that can be all the time in the world for BBC to try to take out a couple of the major heroes. A Necro is really hard to focus down, though, because not only is he rocking the massive armor and magic immunity, as well as some great effective HP, but he's got the cheese. So anytime he's not disabled, he feels he needs to pop that to bring himself back up to full HP, he's going to be in a good spot. We do see up top, there is going to be Weehaw looking for the Hex onto Vanscore, and he gets hardcore creep blocked by the Dire Creeps. MVP creepies, and now it looks like Weehaw's in a bit of a bad spot, though. He will force down and has a haste.
Man, he moves so damn quick now. He just quickly race cars from Slay on the back of a haste towards this top lane. Almost has an opportunity to quickly open up and take out a support grab, but not going to get it. Meanwhile, bottom lane, press on in. It's a boss. They quickly clean out Hockey there on the back end of a Reaper Scythe. He falls, but now looking to make a move. It's Nature's Prophet, immediate BKB, and he's going to try to right click down at least FNG for now. They do get it. Now they turn back to Havos, but Havos, he's big, he's bad, he's not beautiful as Necro, but he can get it done as he just quickly pulls out an additional heal for his allies, pressing on forward. Weehaw with about a quarter life. Can't really engage too hard at this point. Levy moves forward, Lightning Storm trying to slow the roll.
He's coming in.
But here they come, Funnic waiting in the back lines. He's about to drop a huge Ravage Hammer if necessary. Vos, though, puts his attention towards the tower alongside with Dendi, and they're trying to stay spread. Radiant's they gotta know. But look who's creeping in from the side. This is going to be a jump in from behind. Huge Ravage 1, huge Ravage 2, and it cleans out Vos. Immediate set of buybacks coming on out, and Solitude gets cleaned on up, even with the Blade Mail popped. They just turn back forward. Dendi gets out his BKB once more and starts bringing in huge right-click damage. Can he finish off Nature's Prophet? They can. With the help of Funny pushing on in, it's BBC on their last efforts to try to just stop Na'Vi from cleaning out. But all right, they charge on forward here. They get Dendi. Sunstrike comes out, but it's not going to do any respectable damage. Spearbreaker making a move on Skywrath Mage while Dendi presses forward and straight into an ice wall. With no more BKB, is susceptible to big magic damage. Skywrath, negative Urn's going to take him on out. Spearbreaker also falls. Reaper side takes out that Lishrek. They jump back once more and will be able to get the second set of racks and the GG call to come out. From the Balkan Bears, a very hasty and still relatively clowny matchup, but it's still Na'Vi who come out on top.
Amazing. Just amazing. That Phonic Ravage, he actually skirted along the vision of the tower, four staff behind the tree line, and then got the perfect blink right on the Leshrac. He knew that he had to get it on him first because that was the big BKB pop. And he got it so close that there was no way for Levy to react. He wasn't able to survive through the Ravages, and they just took the fight from there. It's also an amusing note that when the Reaper Scythe came off cooldown for Havost. It was actually the Legion Commander still in the grave for 30 seconds. So that means that you could take people out with no buyback available and just delete them from the game so long that you can get the cooldowns back up and not only do it again, but do it to their allies. You can actually have a 5v3 on your hands. Just insane. Really, really great draft from Na'Vi, and they're able to execute it very nicely here at the tail end of it, 46 minutes in.
Na'Vi, in what has to be almost Na'Vi fashion now, have gone from a middle ground point in this round robin and have quickly escalated themselves up to the top of the charts with this win. It looks like they've secured a 6-2 record. No, actually this puts them up to a 7-2 record. This puts them at the top, now even above Power Rangers with their 7-3 record. They're sitting pretty right now, and I think they pretty much have secured themselves a nice little spot into the playoffs. I mean, we'll have to see how the rest of the games do develop with the rest of the teams. And still, unfortunately for the Balkan Bears, we're already out of contention, and now we're going to be sporting a 1-8 record. Best of luck for them for the rest of their matches and their future endeavors. As you know, Weeha, we still see tremendous talent out from him, and the rest of his guys have a lot of room to, you know, kind of grow and develop from there. Really exciting group to watch, but we still have two more games for you today here as two more best of ones will get underway. Our next matchup is going to be Team Tinker taking on Cloud9, and then we will round out the day with Cloud9 taking on BBC. And with that said, we'll go ahead and throw it over to some music and a little bit of a break here. If you like what you heard, catch me on my Twitter over at CoddleGuy. And of course, my co-caster who's been joining me for this long haul is Blaze. Catch him on his Twitter and show him some love at BlazeCasting. A pleasure as always, as we'll be back after this small break.